All right. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 8 tonight. I want to launch off here. This is what you call, by the way, a topical study. We normally take books of the Bible and preach through them. As we're doing in Acts on Sunday morning, we just got through Acts chapter 17. Next Sunday morning, Pastor Ryan will be preaching Acts chapter 18, verses 1 through 17 for us. And then I'll be finishing up our series on heaven next Sunday night. But this is a topical series. And there's a time for topical and doctrinal teaching from God's Word. And so we're not in one passage. We kind of go different places with our study tonight. But 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 8, a verse that we're familiar with. The Apostle Paul says, yes, we are of good courage, and we would rather be away from the body and at home with the Lord. So what we like to say is to be absent from the body is to be what?
Present
with the Lord. At home with the Lord. To be present with the Lord. To be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. That's how most of us have that particular verse memorized. And so what we have been doing in recent Sunday nights together is studying what the Bible teaches about heaven. And so we have studied the topic of, you know, what is heaven and who will be there. And then we looked at what won't be in heaven. Then we looked at what will be in heaven. And last week we looked at when will I go to heaven. Next week we're going to finish out the series talking about what does my knowledge of heaven, how does what I know about heaven now impact my life today? And I just finished writing that late this week. And I'm going to tell you, that message is going to be very important, powerful, and transformative next Sunday night. You don't want to miss next Sunday evening. But I want to tell you, we have learned that there are actually four heavens. There's the atmosphere and the sky. There's outer space. There's the third heaven. That's what 2 Corinthians 5:8 talked about. We studied all this last week. 2 Corinthians 5, verse 8, the third heaven, was called the present heaven in some of the writings, like Randy Alcorn's book, Chip Ingram's book, The Present Heaven. And the present heaven has many things in common with the eternal heaven, but there's one major difference. Now, I want to share this quote with you real quickly. It's from last week, but I just loved it when I was studying and praying this afternoon. I want to share this with you again. Listen to what Dr. Randy Alcorn in his awesome, wonderful book on heaven says. The present intermediate heaven is in the angelic realm, distinctly separate from the earth. By contrast, the future heaven will be in the human realm on earth. Then the dwelling place of God will also be the dwelling place of humanity. In a resurrected universe, that sounds good, doesn't it? A resurrected universe. So heaven and earth, now separated, will then be merged. The new earth will also be heaven, since God will dwell there with his people. Glorified believers, in other words, will continue to be in heaven while they're inhabiting the new earth. This is a picture of God's ultimate plan. Not to take us up to live in a realm made for him, but to come down and live with us in the realm that he made for us. That's Dr. Randy Alcorn. So God is going to, as we said last week, restore, renew, and reconcile this earth. And last week we talked about, well, when will I go to heaven? And we looked a lot in 1 Thessalonians 4, verses 13 through 18. That was kind of a passage we hunkered down in for a little bit last Sunday night as we answered the question, when will I go to heaven? And we said really three things about that. You probably have it in your notes, right? Number one, every person who dies in Christ immediately goes to be with God in the present heaven. That's 2 Corinthians 5:8. Every believer, every Jesus follower, every person who dies in Christ immediately goes to be with God in the present heaven. We said number two, that every saved person alive when Christ returns immediately goes to be with God in the present heaven. That's in 1 Thessalonians 4:16 to 18, when the Lord himself shall descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel, and the trumpet of God shall sound, and of course the dead in Christ are raised first, right? But then we who are alive and remain are called up to be with him in the air. So man, in that moment, in a nanosecond, in the last trumpet of God, as the souls and spirits of those who we know, we talked some last Sunday about people we know who are already there with Jesus right now, man, when the Lord comes back, 1 Thessalonians 4, Jesus comes back and he brings that back those who are asleep in him. And so those souls and spirits are reunited into that decayed body or whatever, that and is transformed in a second into, or less than a second, into the resurrection glorified body that they'll have for all eternity. That's what I am looking for. That is what I'm longing for. You say, Pastor Jay, do you really believe that? I absolutely believe that. I can't explain everything in this book, but you know, again, if we could explain everything about God, then we have a problem.
That's right.
And so we can't do that. But I'm going to tell you what, I believe with all the fervency of my heart, soul, mind, and everything that I am, that everybody who dies in Christ immediately goes to be with God in the present heaven. And then when he comes back, those of us who are alive and remain are going to be called up to be with him in that present heaven at that time. And then we said this last week as we ended the message last week. At the end of the age, the present heaven will come down to the new earth. And that's what we've been looking at in Revelation 21, about the heavenly city, the new Jerusalem, coming down from heaven down to the earth. And so the dwelling place of God will be with the dwelling place of man. And then I ask you a question as we close down. And I ask you this, if you could go to heaven right now or in 10 years, which one would you choose?
Now.
And some people will think, well, preacher, I'm ready to go now. But a lot of people, even Christians, they say, well, you know, I really don't want to go on the bus today. That's the old standing joke, isn't it? I really don't want to go today. And I read a quotation from Chip Ingram's book, and many of you wanted to get that book on heaven by Chip Ingram, and I mentioned it last week, didn't bring it tonight. But, you know, Chip Ingram did a survey as he was doing his book, if you remember. He interviewed some young people about, would you like to go to heaven now? And they said, hey, no, we want to get married and have sex before we go to heaven. Then he interviewed another couple and said, no, we want to get our trip to Hawaii done and in the books before we die and go to heaven. And so it's like Chip Ingram said, well, we know heaven is awesome, but it can't be better than married sex or than going to Hawaii. That's what he said. We covered that. Well, you were out sick last week, so you didn't hear that quote. But that's in the Chip Ingram book that some of you are wanting to get and purchase. Some of you probably ordered it this past week, which is a good book to have, along with Randy Alcorn's book on heaven. Well, tonight as we begin, the question is this. What will I do when I get to heaven? What will I do when I get to heaven? And the thing is, again, this whole concept of do you want to go right now or in 10 years or in 100 years or whatever it might be, we have misconceptions about heaven. We think of clouds. We think of harps. We think of the library. And we think about somebody that's sitting in there saying, shh, don't you know you're in heaven? Shh, be quiet. We imagine heaven as being a non-physical existence. We think of it as a really long church service. We think heaven is going to be boring. Why do you think so many people have that wrong thought about heaven? Why do so many people in this room, you want to be saved and you want to go to heaven when you die, but you don't want to go today. And yet it's going to be the most awesome place ever. Why are so many Christian people not wanting to go to heaven? Where does all this misinformation come about heaven? Who's the father of life? The devil, Satan. I want you to look for a minute in Revelation chapter 13 and verse 6. Let me flip over to the last book of the Bible. It's easy to find. Revelation chapter 13. I'm going to look at one verse there. Revelation chapter 13, verse 6 tells us why there are so many misconceptions about heaven, because we have an enemy and he is a liar. Revelation 13, 6, talking about Satan. It, the beast, opened its mouth to utter blasphemies against God, blaspheming his name and his dwelling, that is, those who dwell in heaven. All right? So here we have Satan blaspheming God and heaven. And so a blasphemy, you hear that word a lot, but most folks don't know what it means. A blasphemy is a false statement. Let me say it again. A blasphemy is a false statement that causes people to have a bad opinion about someone or somewhere. That's what a blasphemy is. It's a it's misinformation. It's a lie. It is a false statement that causes people to have a bad opinion about someone. And so Satan is blaspheming God. And so he plants these ideas that heaven's a long church service, that heaven's going to be boring, Hawaii is going to be a lot better and greater, more awesome than heaven could ever be. So I sure don't want to have the Lord come or me die before I get to Hawaii. The creator of everything has made heaven for us to enjoy for all eternity. In fact, it's going to be Hawaii all over the planet in some regards once that new earth is made. C.S. Lewis said this: joy is serious business in heaven. There's going to be nobody saying, shh, don't you get excited about that. That theology you meditating on in your renewed brain and your renewed body, and you're shouting and praising Jesus, you're out there catching fish or building and designing this new gadget, this new instrument, you're writing that new song, painting that picture when you couldn't paint even in this world, but you can paint in that one. You'll be doing all these different kinds of things going on here. There's going to be joy in the presence of God. Let me give you three big things tonight about what will we do when we get to heaven. All right, number one. We will enjoy fellowship with God. We will enjoy fellowship with God. Now, I know. You hear that, and right away you start thinking about boring. You start thinking, I'm going to enjoy fellowship with God. A long church service. I knew it. He said it wasn't so, but I knew better. I knew the preacher was trying to smooth talk it, and it's just going to be fellowshipping with God, and it's going to be... oh, eternal. But God created you and me to enjoy life in the context with fellowship with Him. Let me say that again. God created us to enjoy life in the context of fellowship with Him. We can't even really begin to taste life until we have a relationship with God.
Amen.
We can't even really begin to taste life until we have a relationship with God. You see, we have our, you know, lost people can have a good time. And let's don't try to deny that. They do. And they can. And they do it in their ways. And a lot of things that they enjoy, we can enjoy right along with them. Now, some stuff we can't, of course, and be holy as He is holy. But some of the stuff we can. I mean, we root for our teams and our car racers, and you know, we enjoy the change of the leaves when we go to the mountains and see that scenery, and we enjoy the sunset at the beach, and we just enjoy things, the creation that God has made. We enjoy beautiful cities and beautiful people and sweet times and good food, and you know, we can do that. But as our theology grows ever deeper into Scripture, we come to understand that in our fellowshipping, our relationship, personal relationship with God, it changes everything. We said it this morning in the message, is that when the Holy Spirit regenerates a man, a woman, a young person, then you have new eyes to see everything differently. Everything. And we experience everything in a different way because of God in our lives. I mean, do you know why we have addictions to drugs, alcohol, pornography, sex, materialism, greed? Why we have all this debt in our lives? It's because human beings are trying to fill the emptiness on the inside that is there that can only be filled with fellowship with God. That's why we have all these addictions. People are trying to find something, aren't they? I mean, a little boy doesn't say, hey, I want to grow up and be a drug salesman, a dope pusher, all right? You don't want to do that. You know, you don't have a little girl saying, I want to grow up to be a prostitute one day. That's not on their list. But because of the brokenness, Because of sin in our world, people end up addicted to drugs and pornography and sex. And there are men who are involved in human trafficking and selling out little girls in hotel rooms to people in Mobile and in America and around the world. And you have all these different addictions. And there are people, these addictions drive, they become a passion that drives people. And they're trying to find something that's missing within them. And John 17:3 is the answer, where Jesus said, "And this is eternal life, that they may know you, the only true God, and Jesus Christ, whom you have sent." Amen? I mean, we need to know God. And I'm going to tell you, when you are right with God, and when you have been regenerated by the Holy Spirit of God, you enjoy fellowship with God. One of the huge problems in the Western church today is we don't enjoy God, and there's a big problem with that. Because the Bible says, hey, if you've been saved, you're going to enjoy God. You're going to talk to Him in prayer. You're going to read His love letter, do you call the Bible. I mean, if we don't want to do that, young people, if we don't want to do that, adults, something's wrong with us spiritually. As I said last week, or was it Wednesday night, that the little red spiritual engine light on your dashboard is going off. That ought to be a warning sign from God tonight. Hey, man, if I don't enjoy God, something isn't right in my life. If I'm not spending time every day in God time in some way, reading the Bible, doing our daily bread, or whatever it might be, hearing from God, talking to God. If we only cry out to God in crises, atheists do that. Think about it. They do. They don't believe in Him until they push comes to shove. Even atheists cry out to God in crisis. And so in heaven, we're going to enjoy fellowship with God. I know Him now, but I still have my flesh. And see, that's the problem with us, is our flesh, our sin nature. I know God now, but I still have my sin nature affecting me. But in heaven, hallelujah, my sin nature will be gone. 1 John 3:2. Go to Revelation. Go to the left of 1 John 3:2. Look at it. It's awesome. It's worth the flip. 1 John 3:2. Check it out. Beloved, we are God's children. What's that word?
Now.
Now. Say now with me. Now.
Now.
Beloved, we are God's children now. Isn't that good? Troy would say, man, God loves me. Man, that ought to bring tears not just to his eyes, to your eyes. I mean, John 17, again, in my God time this week, I was in John 17, and Jesus is teaching us, man, that God loves us as much as He loves Jesus. It's in the book. You read it, you find it. It's in there. Man, when you're in Christ and Christ is in you, God, you're no longer the child of wrath. All right, Ephesians 2:3. Man, you've been adopted into God's family. Now you are a blessed child of God. He loves you. He gave His only Son, Jesus, to die for you so you could be in His family. Amen. That shows us the love of God. So, beloved, we are God's children. What? Right now. And what we will be has not yet appeared. But we know that when He appears, we shall be like Him because we shall see Him as He is. And everyone who thus hopes in Him purifies himself as he is pure. There's going to come. We've already seen in Revelation chapter 22 where it says there'll be nothing corrupt in heaven. You know what? The most corrupt thing about me is my flesh. And it ain't ever getting no better. The Spirit got to slay it every day. When I wake up in the middle of the night, Holy Spirit, slay my flesh. Cleanse my mind. Sanctify my body. Use my hands as the hands of Jesus. Use my feet as the feet of Jesus. I mean, man, we got a battle. I'm so glad Pastor Glad said this board that's going to be in the gym. We have our fellowship here in a few minutes. You know, I got hurt. Always happens to me. Always. All right. If you're struggling with something, young people, go put it on the board. If you're a Christian and you're not struggling with something, then you're not being honest with yourself. We are. You just got to have enough courage to admit it. And that's where you find the mercy and the grace and the help when you do. Because God opposes the proud. But He gives grace to the humble. When you just go to Father, I'm a mess. I'm an emotional mess, a financial mess, a spiritual mess, a parenting mess, a wife mess, a husband mess. I'm a child mess. Whatever. If you just be honest and say, God, I need you. That's where that comes in, all right? So number one, we will enjoy fellowship with God. Number two, we will enjoy relationships with one another. We will enjoy relationships with one another. That's what we're going to do. Our relationships will transcend our cultural differences. This is Revelation chapter 5, verse 9 and 10. Let me share that with you real quick. Revelation chapter 5, verses 9 and 10. And notice what the Apostle John writes down. And they sang a new song saying, "Worthy are you to take the scroll and to open its seals, for you were slain, and by your blood you ransomed people for God from every tribe and language and people and nation. And you have made them a kingdom and priests to our God, and they shall reign on the..." Where does that say?
Earth.
That's the future tense, by the way. They shall reign on the earth, meaning that, hey, when the new earth comes, hey, we're going to be a kingdom of priests down here with the Lord on the new earth. Amen. But my point for right now is, man, there's going to be folks from every tribe, language, people, and nation. What I was saying here is this: our relationships will transcend our cultural differences. Heaven will not diminish our cultural differences, but rather celebrate them. Number two, our relationships will transcend time and space limitations. Our relationships, right, with others that we're going to have, that will transcend time and space limitations. What I'm talking about is this: we're going to see Moses. That's going to be cool, isn't it? You look nothing like Charlton Heston in the movie. You're not what I was expecting, you know. But you got to let this just kind of saturate your mind. We're going to see Moses and Jonah, all right, and see what his resurrection might look like. It's better than one he left the earth with, amen. We're going to see Moses, Jonah, David, Paul, Mark, Luther, John Calvin, Jonathan Edwards, D.L. Moody, Charles Spurgeon, Billy Graham one day. We're going to see all of them. And then the loved ones we know personally interact. But what I'm saying is that we will enjoy relationships with one another, and our relationships will transcend time and space limitations. People we've only read about in the Bible, people we've read about in church history, man, we're going to be able to just mosey up to them sometime and talk to them as we're doing our little Jetson space car. I don't know what it's all going to be. The Bible doesn't tell us what we're going to have. I believe we're going to be working to create, and I'm going to talk about that in my last point coming up here in just a minute. And I got to hurry to it. Number three in the relationships, we enjoy relationships with one another. Our relationships will be unhindered by the effects of sin. And glory, hallelujah. Our relationships will be unhindered by the effects of sin. Everything that makes relationship hard right now is gone. Anger, unforgiving spirit, jealousy, bitterness, lust, dishonesty, greed, selfishness, unforgiveness, envy, all of that, when the flesh is dealt with and gone, all that's gone. Our relationships with one another will be completely holy and perfect and pure and transparent. That's awesome. The third thing we're going to do in heaven. Number one is we're going to have fellowship with God eternally. Number two, we will enjoy relationships with one another. Number three, in heaven, we will enjoy life as God intended it to be. We will enjoy life as God intended it to be. Now, let me draw some stuff here. Number one, under that, we will enjoy life as human beings on the new earth. That's Revelation 21. We don't have time to turn and read like I wanted to. Revelation 21, again, that third heaven, the present heaven, is going to come down to the earth, the new heaven, and new earth, right? That city, 1,380 miles long, wide, and tall, will come down to the earth, all right? And that's just the city. That's not the whole planet, which will be remade as a new earth. So we're going to enjoy life as human beings, not floating around celestially on clouds, eating cream cheese and plucking harps, all right? And having eternal choir practice. You got my robe on. Well, see, there wouldn't be no fussing about robes if they had robes, all right? Because you're going to get along, right? We will enjoy life as human beings on the new earth. Number two, we're going to work. Now that just bums some of you out. But you got to realize God created us to work. And there was work before there was ever sin.
Right.
And work is a good thing. It glorifies God. It's good for you and me. And so we need a good work ethic. The Bible teaches that. But in heaven, I believe we're going to work. What are we going to do? I don't know. I don't know if there won't be undertaker work in heaven. No plastic surgeon's going to be in business in heaven. You ain't going to mess with my resurrection body. You couldn't change the contraption. Won't be any police officers in heaven. Right? So NCIS, you better get it all while you got it down here, because it won't be there in heaven. Won't happen. But we're going to work. I told you Wednesday night, some days I just dream of flipping burgers or Whataburger and eating the ones I mess up. Oh, you didn't want jalapenos on that one. I'm sorry. All right, let me take that. I got that one. I misunderstood. I'm sorry, ma'am, up front. I read the screen wrong. Some days that sounds more appealing than what I do. Some days. But we're going to work. Number three, we're going to create. And I'm going to tell you something, that Dr. Randy Alcorn book, the last two or three chapters in that book, he answers questions about what we're going to be doing on the new earth. He'll give you a lot more information. So if you get that book, I think we may be out on the resource table right now from the book on heaven by Randy Alcorn. But I'm going to tell you, that is a book. It's bigger than the one I mentioned last week, Chip Ingram. They're both good, but man, Alcorn answers questions you hadn't even thought to ask. It's the deeper book of the two, and you ought to try to get Randy Alcorn and read that book for good theology. But we will be creating things. I don't even have time to talk about it. And we're going to eat. We're going to eat. Jesus didn't prove that after the resurrection. He ate some stuff, so we're going to be eating. And think about it. We're going to have our resurrection bodies, and man, we're going to have taste buds firing, and our brain will be fully operational, where right now it's just a small percentage, less for some of us than others, but our brains will be fully operating all through and everything in that resurrection. We're going to taste stuff that filet mignon never tasted as good as it will in the new earth. And whatever it is God has for us to eat, we're going to love that food, and there'll be no wait in the line. All right, we'll be eating. And then the last thing I'm going to say is this. We're going to laugh and have a good time. There'll be no, shh, you're in heaven. Keep it down. I really believe we're going to laugh and have a good time. See, God has a sense of humor. Amen?
Amen.
And if you guys, but eat capitals, that's good Baptist. If y'all got that picture of Blobfish, man. You got your picture of Bob Fish. God has a sense of humor. Look at that thing right there. Now, if God can make that, and he did, because you and I did, it's called the Blobfish. Go Google pics and images and look that thing up. There's another picture in the list that I found this afternoon on there that's disrespectful to our president. But anyway, you'll have to look that up and see that. You can strike that from the tape. But this is the Blobfish. All right, this is the Blobfish. And look at that rascal. God made, it looks like something out of a Disney movie, doesn't it? It's real. It's called the Blobfish. God has a sense of humor. In fact, you know, there's another verse that I remember a lot. A merry heart does good like a medicine. But a broken spirit drives up the bones. God gave us, I mean, who gave us laughter? Who gave us music? Who gave us art? Who gave us literature? God. And so we are going to laugh and enjoy ourselves in that presence of God eternally as we live in a renewed, reinvigorated earth with no sin, no bodily limitations of sin, and no desire to sin. Heaven is going to be a great, great place. There's a golfer. I close with this. There's a golfer named Paul Azinger. I guess I'm saying the name right. I'm not into golf very much. But I looked him up on the internet today. Paul Azinger wrote a book called Zinger. You see, in 1993, he was diagnosed with cancer. And he underwent, I think, 6 months of chemotherapy and 5 weeks or so of radiation. Paul Azinger, professional golfer. In his book entitled Zinger, when he wrote about his experience with cancer and the fight and the battle and overcoming that, he said this. We think we're in the land of the living, going to the land of the dying, but the reality is we're in the land of the dying, and we're headed to the land of the living. Amen. You see, you and I, there he is right there, Paul Azinger. You and I, right now, are in the land where our bodies are. Our outer man is perishing, and the inner man in Christ is being renewed day by day. We tend to think, man, this is what it's all about. But this truly is the land of the dying, and in Christ we're headed to the land of the living. And tonight, my prayer for you is that you know Him. That you know, that you know, that you know, that you know that you're saved. Are you the child of God right now, like 1 John 3:2 said? See, we can know that. Do you know that? Do you have that assurance that God has saved you? Purchased you with the blood of His only Son, Jesus. Do you have the inner witness of the Holy Spirit who bears witness with your spirit, Romans 8:16, that you're now a child of God? An heir of God and a joint co-heir of Christ. Tonight, we're going to just have a time of response if you need to come for prayer. Or if you just want to do business with God right where you are, we invite you to do that.